¿Qué tal? Bienvenidos al Instituto de Psicofarmacología. Mi nombre es Flavio Guzmán, soy médico psiquiatra y el editor a cargo de esta plataforma educativa. Esperamos que estas conversaciones con académicos e investigadores le brinden herramientas para su práctica clínica y que también contribuyan a su formación continua. En este episodio, nuestro invitado es el doctor David Bill, quien nos hablará sobre el TOC resistente al tratamiento. Su grupo publicó un artículo en la revista BMC denominado Potenciación con antipsicóticos atípicos en el trastorno obsesivo-compulsivo refractario al tratamiento con ISRS, una revisión y meta-análisis. El Dr. Bill es profesor senior visitante en el Instituto de Psiquiatría del King's College de Londres, en el Reino Unido. También es un investigador activo en la temática de trastorno dismórfico corporal y emetofobia. El tratamiento del trastorno obsesivo compulsivo representa un desafío. La resistencia al tratamiento es bastante común. Entre el 40 al 60% de los pacientes no muestran una respuesta adecuada a los tratamientos de primera línea. Además, tenemos un problema extra, que es que en la actualidad no tenemos una definición estándar de resistencia al tratamiento. Es por eso que le pedí al Dr. Bill que nos ayudara con una definición práctica.
Well, I mean, research has used various criteria in terms of the percentage reduction on standardized scales like the Yale-Brown Obsessive Compulsive Scale. But for clinicians, I think it's primarily about whether your patient remains significantly distressed or handicapped, interfered in their life by their symptoms of OCD. So I think it's just quite, you know, they still have OCD.
Nuestro invitado ahora describe un enfoque escalonado para el tratamiento del TOC. Esto incluye cómo utilizar los ISRS, el papel de la clomipramina, un enfoque escalonado también para la terapia cognitivo-conductual y cuándo utilizar antipsicóticos. El Dr. Bill analiza los resultados de su meta-análisis.
In general, we'd use a stepped approach in medication. And so, as you say, you start off with one SSRI, and the problem is often is that people don't necessarily use it at the maximum tolerated dose for at least 3 or 4 months, because you know, there is this dose-response relationship. Unless you get up to the highest tolerated dose for at least 3 months, then you can't really say whether you've not had any benefit from it or anything. Yeah. Now, it's true that sometimes people can't tolerate higher doses, but that's the thing to aim for. And as you say, if that doesn't work, you'd go on to an alternative SSRI. Again, maximum tolerated dose for at least 3 months. Then you might want to consider clomipramine. Again, as you know, a little bit more difficult to use because you're more likely to get side effects in the higher doses and so on. But certainly two SSRIs and clomipramine would be the sort of pharmacological stepped approach. And it often depends upon, obviously, the availability of CBT. But, you know, CBT is also done in a stepped approach, because if you get more intensive CBT, then it may be a more experienced therapist or more frequent sessions and so on. So, you know, both of those can go together. The question is then what you do if, you know, you're still distressed and handicapped. And that's when the antipsychotics come in. And so you'd be staying on the maximum tolerated SSRI. And the meta-analysis found that mainly it's best to use probably aripiprazole or risperidone. Aripiprazole and risperidone are probably the most effective in OCD, or at least that's what the meta-analysis shows. But the key issue is that it's not like using an antipsychotics for schizophrenia or something, and that, you know, you can use quite low doses. So some of the trials found risperidone at even 0.5 milligrams was effective. And so equivalent of aripiprazole might be 2.5 or 5 milligrams. So you can use quite low doses. And furthermore, you can find out whether it's been effective or not within 4 weeks. So that, you know, if it really has had no benefit in 4 weeks at a low dose, well, possibly some people might increase the dose, but, you know, it's probably very unlikely to have any further benefit. And you might well then want to discontinue it. It's not something that you just want to leave someone on for many months and years, like, you know, something you would be perhaps with an antipsychotic in schizophrenia. You know, if it's not working, there's no point in staying on it, really.
What if it works?
Then you'd probably want to stay on it. But what we don't know is actually all these studies so far have only been done for 3 months or so. And no one's actually done any good studies in the long term. There's a small study that suggests if you are getting benefit and then you stop taking it, then you're more likely to relapse. But, you know, there's one long-term study going on at the moment in Japan on aripiprazole. And I think that's going to be looking, we'll look forward to that because people want to know how effective it is in the long term. You know, does the effect wear off over time or anything? We just don't know. But the key issue is that, you know, low doses for at least a month, and then you can decide whether to remain on it or not.
Is there a symptom profile useful to identify those patients that might show response to antipsychotics?
People have looked at this, and, you know, one or two trials said, first of all, that people with comorbid tics, but then that didn't come out in other trials, and certain, perhaps sometimes certain types of symptoms. It may be if you're highly anxious or something, it might just help to reduce your level of arousal, but, you know, there's no good evidence really at all. No one knows. It's just a matter of trial and error, to be honest.
What other options do we have for treatment-resistant OCD?
The only other thing to say is that there is some evidence, you know, like one or two isolated trials from mega doses of SSRIs, that, you know, very high levels of SSRIs. But you would need to do ECG monitoring and, you know, serum monitoring of the particular drug thing. You know, if you're going to go up to sertraline 400 or fluoxetine 120 or 60 or something. So that these are done sometimes because there are some people who are maybe quite rapid metabolizers and things like that. So occasionally you that might be worth investigating. Mm-hmm. And there are one or two trials done on lamotrigine. That's has been adding to an SSRI and a trial on memantine adding to an SSRI. So there is a sort of scraping the barrel to, you know, certain types of medications at the bottom of the barrel, but it's tough. And probably there is a group of patients who really struggle with all medications and the CBT as well. And certainly at our own unit, we have such patients are in our residential unit, like an inpatient unit, and they get intensive therapy. So that, you know, you're getting CBT 3-4 times a week with an assistant therapist, and it's the right environment in terms of support and so on. So if that doesn't work, then there is experimental work going on in terms of looking at deep brain stimulation. So there's always something around the corner.
Este fue el Dr. David Bill refiriéndose al TOC resistente al tratamiento. Para más actualizaciones en psicofarmacología clínica, visite el sitio web del Instituto de Psicofarmacología, institutodepsicofarmacología.com. Si desea descargar este video y acceder a actualizaciones exclusivas y certificación, también puede suscribirse a nuestro programa de formación continua. Muchas gracias.